So
we're live.
Yay. Looks like it's working. So people, for all the 4,090 something of you, thanks for bearing with us. And I'm here with the one and only Talia Wolf, the let's say the fairy queen of CRO worldwide. Thanks a lot for being part of this, Talia. She's the founder of Get Uplift. Talia, please share your screen so that I can pass the mic to you.
Sounds good. I'm going to turn my cam off so that nothing disturbs us. And I'm going to share my screen. And just let me know that you can see my slides loud and clear and that everything's working.
Yeah, it's working.
Awesome, guys. Thank you so much for being patient. I'm waiting for this to work. Hopefully you're going to walk away from this presentation with tons and tons of value. I've already shared the link to all the resources because I'm going to mention a ton of free resources that we have here. So don't worry about it. I have a link for that and you can download it right after this session. Okay, so today we're going to be talking about emotion. And I'll start by telling you about the question that I ask every single client of mine. So before we get started, the first question I ask them is, why do people buy from you? So what actually makes people come into your store and choose your products over your competitors? And normally, the answers that I get are very similar to these. So it's always something to do with the pricing, shipping, the features, maybe the way that the product is built or how many awards you've run, all to do with the product itself. However, the easiest way for me to explain why this is incorrect is by showing you an example. So I believe that if people really did buy products because of their features or their pricing, then Coca-Cola would have landing pages like this. They would say that they are the number one soft drink in the world. They talk about how many calories they have, how much they cost. They talk about how well known they are. They'd have an image of the bottle and they just have a button that says, you know, like order now. But you would never, ever, ever see something like this by Coca-Cola and almost any other big brand in the world. And it's not because of the budgets that they have, it's because they understand a very important concept that most businesses don't. But before I get into that concept, let me show you an example, because even though we know that we would never see these big companies do anything like this, not them, not Lego, not Nike, and no one would actually do anything like this, we still see the biggest stores in the world use this kind of methodology. So we talk about the pricing and how much it costs. We talk about getting all the cash back. It's always about the product, the pricing. It's about how amazing it is, how great the product is. So it's always about the product and the product and the product. That's all we hear about. However, the biggest brands in the world know that this isn't how people buy things. And I think it all goes back to understanding how people buy. And the thing is that most of us seem to think that this is how people buy. So if we have a decision to make, we go about it in a way where we think about all the advantages, the disadvantages, the pros, the cons, and then we make a logical decision. However, the biggest brands in the world, the Nikes, the Slack, the Lego, as I mentioned, and even Coca-Cola know that this isn't how people buy products. This is. Every single decision that we make in life is based on emotion, psychology. In fact, the Antonio Damasio, one of the biggest researchers and most well-known researchers, ran an entire science research on people who have brain damage. Now, these people had everything was okay with them except for one specific thing. They couldn't feel emotions. That was their issue. And he ran an experiment with them. And what he found out was that they lived a normal life. However, due to the fact that they didn't feel any emotions, they couldn't make any decision. What that means is they couldn't even choose between what sandwich to eat, if they were going to have an avocado sandwich or if they were going to have a peanut butter sandwich. any decision in life was too complicated and hard for them to make. And the reason for that is because emotion affects every single decision we make in life. Without emotion, we can't make decisions. And that we love to explain to ourselves and say that we're logical and that we make, you know, logical decisions. At the end of the day, emotion is what steers that decision, what it dictates the decision. And later on, we actually kind of rationalize that decision. So for example, if you go into a store today and you buy a 500, or not today because you can't go into a store, but if you order online, you order online this a t-shirt for $250, you will find a way to convince yourself why that decision was the best decision you could have made, that you have to have that t-shirt and it's the best decision. Because we are first motivated by emotion and then we rationalize it. And no matter what you're selling, people always want to feel something. So whether it's because they want to feel loved, maybe they want to feel like they're part of a community, maybe they want to feel more successful. Sometimes they just want to feel better about themselves and increase their higher, you know, their self-esteem. But no matter what you're selling, what people really care about isn't the what, it's the why. And that is the bottom line of marketing and businesses in general. So that's why companies like Coca-Cola will never talk about their calories, how many bottles they've sold, or how many people buy from them, or how much it costs. They make you feel something towards their brand. And it doesn't have to be something that is, that includes a ton of budget and a ton of resources. They just understand how people make decisions. They understand that emotion dictates everything. However, when I ask my clients who their customer is, at the end of the day, what I get is a long list of data. And that's because most of us as marketers have been told that we need to focus on data, be data driven. So we talk about the geographical location, we talk about age, we talk about browsers, devices, gender, but we don't really know the actual people behind the screen and how they make decisions. And then we face the problem. So we look at our landing page, or we look at our product page, and we look at our homepage, and we say, okay, something needs to be fixed. There's a problem on our homepage. So step number two, we'll say, okay, let's create a new variation. And then we're just going to launch an A/B test. So finding the leak in the funnel is pretty simple, right? You go into Google Analytics and you know, okay, here's the problem. This is where people are failing. I'm having a problem with my product page. I have a problem with the category page. Maybe there's a big leak in the checkout flow, but you can find it pretty easily. Launching an A/B test can take some time to learn, but it's a technical thing. You can do that. However, how do you know how to create a new variation? What variation is going to make a change? Most people don't, right? It's a guessing game. So most A/B tests actually look something like this. We have a call to action button, which says, let's say the call to action is pink and we have all this content and it says, hey, we're amazing. We really are. You should buy from us. Here's all these amazing features that we have. Here's a video of how to use the product. It's fantastic. And then you say, okay, I need to fix this page. So let's change the call to action button. And you change the color and you get no results, or maybe you get a bit of an uplift. But what do you actually learn from this type of test? You don't learn much. And even if it did increase conversions, what are you actually going to do with this result? You're not going to be able to scale it. You're not going to be able to learn from it and change anything for really scaling and growing your revenue. And the reason this happens is because people seem to think that conversion optimization is about changing elements on the page. When you find a leak in the funnel, something's wrong, the best way to fix it is by just changing a call to action button, or maybe changing an image. But conversion optimization isn't about changing an element on the page. It's about solving people's problems. It's about understanding those emotions, understanding the pain that's driving people to your website. What are they feeling? What are they worried about? What's keeping them up at night? Why are they coming to your website? Understanding those decision makers, understanding what lies behind those decisions in terms of emotions. And this is where the emotional targeting methodology comes in. So I built this over the past decade. It's the methodology that I use with all my clients. I teach it to all my students in our courses. And the essence of it is about identifying the emotional triggers of our customers, understanding the emotions that impact people's decisions, and then using that, once I understand those emotions, what the pain is, what the challenges are, and their desired outcomes, then I can create a better experience. So I can write better copy when I know what people are feeling. I can choose better images. I can do better outline for a page. Everything I do is based on those emotions, and that's how I 10 times and 20 times conversions for my clients and my students. So at the end of the day, the emotional targeting methodology is here to answer four core questions. Number one, what pain does my customer feel before finding a solution? What are the emotional triggers that drive her decision making? What are her hesitations and concerns? And finally, what does she want to feel after finding a solution? These are the core questions that every single one of you should know how to answer. So right now, you should be able to look at these questions and say, I know the answers to these. Because when you know the answer to these questions, you can write better copy, you can send better emails, you can design better flows and funnels, you can sell more. And it's all about understanding those people and understanding those emotions. Now, during this 10 years when I've built this process, we've discovered 223 different emotions. And normally, there's more than just one emotion at play. There's a couple of them that are playing with different people and how they feel and what's driving their decisions. So I want to show you a case study. And I'll give you an example of a client that turned to me a while ago and said to me, listen, we need to increase conversions. And what this product does is essentially help you create beautiful infographics and different presentations. And they showed me the landing page and I looked at it and I said, okay, so what have you done so far? So here's what they actually tested before we started working with them. They tried working on loading time. They changed call to action buttons. They reduced a few steps in the forms. They changed the headline and they added an exit pop-up. However, when I asked them, hey, you know, what is the results that you're seeing? What did you see? And they said, well, nothing barely moved them, you know, nothing basically worked. We barely moved the needle. We need something better. So when I looked at the landing page, I saw the things that we just mentioned. Everything on this page is about the product. Everything is about them. Easy to use infographic creator is about the platform. There are six bullet points here, all about the features, the templates, how it works. And the main visual, the hero image here, is a video that is literally a drag and drop showing you how to move things from one side to the next in the platform itself. There's nothing in here about the person behind the screen, their pain, their emotions, how it's going to change their life, and what it's going to do for them, their value. So we helped them increase their conversions, and we did this by identifying the emotional triggers and using them on a landing page. So I'm going to show you three ways that you can identify your customers' emotional triggers, and this is going to be very actionable, and I can send you all of this stuff and how to do it later. So here's three ways for you to identify your customers' emotional triggers. Step number one, identify their stage of awareness. So the most important thing to remember is that people aren't coming to your website feeling the same. They're not in the same stage in the customer journey. Every person is in a different stage, and there are actually five different stages. Now, if you can identify the stage of awareness that your prospect is in, it's actually far more easier to choose the right content that should be on each page. It could be the content that you're putting in an ad, and it can be a content for your homepage, and it can either be the content for a product page. So there are five stages of awareness. Stage number one is the unaware stage. These are people who are unaware that they have a problem, that they have a pain. And your only job for people who are unaware is to let them know about the pain, is to agitate that pain and tell them that they have a problem. So for example, let's say that you're working in a team and you have a team that's distributed. And right now we're in this time where everyone's distributed. People are working from home, trying to stay safe and social distancing. And let's say that your team is all over and you're trying to communicate with people. So unaware people may not be aware of the fact that there's a problem communicating with your team. So the only job that you have to do here is tell them that they have a problem with communicating, there's a problem in their team, and they need to fix it. That's all you have to do. No selling, no talking about your product, just about their specific problem that they're facing, bringing that pain up to their awareness. The second stage of the awareness is pain-aware people. And pain-aware people are people that are aware. So they know that they have a problem communicating with their team, but they don't know that there are solutions out there that can solve it. Then there's solution-aware. Solution-aware people are people who know that there are solutions out there, but they're not sure what the right one is. For them is. So maybe it's a software, maybe it's going for a workshop, maybe they need to find a better way to communicate via email, maybe they can read some blog posts. So solution aware people are people who are actually actively doing some research and they're trying to figure out what's the right solution for them. If your prospects are solution aware and they're not entirely sold that they even need a product, then your only job is to write articles and content and create content around that issue of the different solutions that are at hand that they can use and why they should consider a product. Then we have product aware people. And product aware people are people who are specifically aware of your solution. And they're also aware of your competitor's solution. And at this point, they're evaluating products. Now, here's an interesting thing. This is the first time in your entire stage of awareness that you actually start talking about your product. All of the other stages require you to talk about the customer, their pain, what they're going through, the different solutions that they can find. And only when people get to the product aware stage is when you start talking about your product and how it's different from your competitors. And lastly, we have the most aware stage. Most aware people are people who are ready to buy. They just need the right call to action button. Now, how do you identify these stages of awareness? There's actually quite easy ways to do it. So step number one, do a keyword research. So look at the keywords that people are using to arrive to your website. You can look at the Search Console and see what terms people are using. So for example, if someone's using a term like how to collaborate with my distributed team, then you know that they are solution aware. These are people that are looking for solutions. But if people are looking for your specific brand, then they're probably product aware because they know of you and they're trying to decide if you are right for them. You can also look at the keywords that people are using on your website if you have internal search on your website, which most e-commerce sites do. If you can see what people are looking for, are they looking for specific products or are they searching for questions? Are they reading looking for specific content? Second way is to look at the landing pages. Where are people landing? Are they landing on your blog? So they're probably solution aware. They're trying to read an article. Are they landing on a product page? Okay, they're aware of a specific product. Are they landing on a category page? If they're landing on a category page, maybe they're aware, maybe they're solution aware and they're trying to figure out what is the right product for them. So again, using the stages of the awareness is a great way to identify what content you need to put on the page. Now, with our client, when we were doing our conversion optimization research, we realized that their prospects were solution aware. So this was the important part. We needed to understand the stage of the awareness and we identified it. Next step is talking to the customers. Now, I know some people think like, holy no, I can't do this. Doesn't make any sense. I've never spoken to my customers, or even if I have, it doesn't make any sense. I won't do it. So for me and to me, I see this as a very problematic issue because if you're not speaking to your customers, and what I mean by speaking to your customers, this means surveying them, emailing them, and interviewing them on calls. If you're not doing that, it's essentially like spending months and months of planning this amazing product when you're absolutely sure that everyone's going to love it and everyone's going to identify with it and everyone's going to buy it, only to find out 5 months later, once you've launched the product, that no one actually wants it or is going to use it. Customer research, and I'm talking about meaningful customer research, can be the difference between launching a failing product and a highly successful one. And it also gives you amazing, amazing copy, because when you talk to people, you can understand what they need to see on a page, what words you need to use to convince them. The thing is that when it comes to customer surveys, most websites ask very, very generic questions that don't give you any information. So that's why many times when I ask people if they do customer surveys, they say, I don't really learn anything from them. So I have a list of my favorite questions that I like to ask, and each one of them can help you greatly in understanding your customers better and what content you need to provide on a page for it to be high converting. Question number one, what pain does the product solve for you? What was going on in your life or your day that made you search for this solution? When you weren't using our solution, how did you solve this problem? And if you couldn't use this solution anymore, what would you miss the most? Every single one of these questions will give you high valuable answers. For example, understanding what people were using before they used your solution is a great way to help people who are pain aware or solution aware to figure out how to, and a great way to basically use great content on there. So many people think that if you ask them, hey, how did you solve this problem beforehand, they're going to mention a competitor. But many times it's not going to be a competitor. It's going to be, oh, I used a spreadsheet, or I wasn't solving the problem, or I had an intern, or my cousin did it for me. It's always going to be these kind of interesting answers to this question. And what's great about it is that later on, you can use that and reflect that in your copy. So you can say to people, we know that you've tried 1, 2, 3, and 4, and it doesn't work. Here's a solution that does. When you do that, you're relating to people and you're showing them that you know them. Question number four, if you couldn't use this solution anymore, what would you miss the most? This is a wonderful question that I picked up years ago from AG Consult, and it's a great way to understand the true value of your product. Instead of asking them, hey, you know, what's your favorite thing? When you ask people, hey, if I took this product away from you tomorrow, what would you miss the most? You get the true value of things. Now, here's a pro tip, because I mentioned at the beginning that most of us really do think that we're rational. And that means that when we ask people questions, we're going to get quite mundane answers. People are going to say, give you answers that aren't really interesting. And your job is to dig into the interesting and find those amazing, valuable answers. So my tip is that you want to keep asking why until there are no whys left. I call it the 5 whys, and I'm going to show you how we used it for this specific client. So we asked them, hey, what persuaded you to sign up? And most of them said, you have the most features. And I said, that's amazing and that's great, but why do you need so many features? And they said, well, I needed something different. And I said, okay, that's interesting, but why do you need something different? There's so many products out there for presentations that are free, and they're great. There's, you know, Keynote, there's PowerPoint. Why would you need something different? And they said, well, I wanted to create something memorable. So we said to them, okay, cool, that's really interesting. Why do you need to create something memorable? And their answer was, I needed to stand out, or someone said, I want to be appreciated by my peers or my managers. Now, guys, this is why people signed up. This is the real reason. These are the emotions behind that sign up. So when I ask people why they sign up, yeah, they'll say, hey, it's the features, or it's the pricing, or it's whatever it is. But when you dig deep and you keep asking why, and you don't weigh in on that question and that answer, you get the true real value. These people, when we did our research, we realized that these are marketers that are drowning in a sea of marketers, and everyone around them is doing a ton of work and showing themselves. And these people wanted to get more appreciation from their colleagues and their managers for the work that they were doing. They were spending a lot of time running campaigns, creating landing pages, creating presentations. And at the end of the day, no one remembered them or their work. So for them, finding this tool was a great way to really stand out and make a difference. And that is the emotions, and that's what we should be using on our page. So when we ran the research and we ran these surveys, here's what we learned. We learned that people really wanted to stand out. We learned that people wanted to be appreciated. And we also learned that they were worried about not having design skills, because creating presentations sounds like you have to have a design skills. You need to be a designer. So these are the three things that we learned from speaking to our customers. Lastly, the step number three for finding the emotional triggers of your prospects is listening to your prospects. And this is a different kind of listening. This is something that's called review mining. And what you do here is you essentially go online and you go to the places where your audience is at. This is different forums, Facebook groups, Quora, the books that they're reading. You want to go to really get into what people are, where people are at, what they're talking about, the communities that they're in, and start reading all the content that they're putting out there. What are they complaining about? What are they saying? What are they praising? What are the best things that have happened to them? When you start listening to that stuff, then you better understand what content needs to be on the page and how you can create a better experience for them, the biggest roadblocks that they have. These are all the things that should be on your website. And another way that's really cool is to analyze competitor websites. So if you go to your competitors, you'll notice all the reviews that they're getting. Now, these are people that should be buying from you, and they're buying from your competitor. You're not going onto your competitor's website to look at their product. You're going there to see what people are saying about them. What are the sentiments that people are saying? How are people finding their solution? So for example, over here, this is a research that we did on Prezi, and because it's a competitor of our client. And a lot of the things that people were saying here was, hey, it helped me showcase my presentation skills. Or now everyone knows Prezi. People see the presentations and they just think, oh, well, yes, that's Prezi. It would be cool if Prezi did something new that could bring more attention to us. Helpful and bring attention to our to the public. So essentially everything in here is about people's, how they look, how they're perceived. Everyone that we looked at wanted to have that attention and feel like they were going to stand out in the crowd and really become that amazing marketer and show people how good they are. So after we analyzed all the competitor websites, we went to books that people are reading, we analyzed Amazon reviews, we analyzed all these Facebook group comments and the threads that people were talking about, then we realized, okay, so what do people want to read, see, and feel on the page now that we have really done all this research? So we knew that they wanted to see the outcome. They wanted to feel like this is going to be an amazing outcome. We know that we wanted to tell them that they are great at what they do, and we're simply going to make people notice them. And we also knew that we wanted to make them feel like it's simple and easy to use. So going back to the original page, we created this. So make impressive infographics. This is the outcome. This is what you're going to create. It's not the easy to use infographic creator. It's make impressive infographics. We're empowering people by telling them they can create beautiful infographics in 10 minutes. And we're also showing them the outcome. We're not talking about what the product looks like. We're not showing them how to use the product. We're literally showing them the beautiful results that they can get in 10 minutes. Now, using this method, we got a 24% increase in registrations and 76% increase in creation of presentations. Here's another variation that we created. Make impressive infographics, create beautiful infographics in less than 10 minutes. And instead of showing the product, we featured a feeling of magic, like pulling a hat out of a hat, like pulling a rabbit out of a magic hat. That is what it should feel like. It's like magic. And this got 76%, a 74% increase in revenue. Okay, so here's the bottom line of what I'm trying to say to you guys today. Emotions affect decisions. Decisions affect conversions, and conversions affect revenue. So instead of asking what your goal is, what you want to start asking is, what is my customer's goal? Because only when your customers achieve their goals will you achieve your own. So I want to thank you very much for waiting for all this time and listening to all this. You can grab a ton of our free resources and all our templates over here on this website, including our 30 plus psychological triggers and how to use them on your website. So hopefully this was very helpful. I don't know if we have time for questions, but I'm happy to answer any if we do.
Unfortunately, Talia, we don't have time for questions because we are delayed as well. But if people have questions, they can ask you in our Slack group where you're invited as well. I'm going to give you the link. And for all of you out there, thanks for listening. And you can find Talia on getuplift.co and our Slack channel. And now Brett gets it's on the next track. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Bye.
As an e-commerce manager, you want to stop spending money on expensive ads. OmniConvert Explore helps you improve conversion through A/B testing, personalization, and surveys. Understand that growth is also a matter of retention, not only acquisition. With OmniConvert Reveal, you'll understand segments, monitor customer experience, and nurture your customers on every channel.